Well, a GDP was conceived during World War II by John Maynard Keynes as a way of taxing the British people for the war effort. So what it does is it counts all the things we spend money on and adds those all up, including expenditures on car crashes or divorce or environmental pollution cleanup. Now, intuitively, we'd say that is a flawed way of accounting for progress. Things that we would not want to spend money on, like cleaning up after a hurricane, presumably should either be treated as a discrete, you know, item on the income statement of the nation as potentially a negative or at least a regrettable expenditure. At the same time, the GDP fails to measure things like the time we spend with our families or our children or volunteering, things that actually contribute to social capital of a society. So it fails on one hand to measure the things that make life worthwhile, as Robert Kennedy said, and it inappropriately measures the things that we are degrading our social, our human, and natural capital. The other thing that's flawed is there's no balance sheet for the nation. The GDP is like an income statement with just looking at expenditures or revenues. If there's no accounting of the assets, of the capital that actually underscores society, human, social, natural capital, then we are flying a 747 with a joystick. And the joystick has been GDP, and it's time for us to mature and grow up and redesign the whole national, international accounting system. Our whole economy, the global economy, is based on debt money. That means that every mortgage, which means a pledge unto death in French, contributes to a collective debt enslavement economy. All of us are basically working about 42 cents on every dollar we spend. It goes to interest payments on the collective debt. We see over time, with the power, beautiful power of compound interest, that debt grows and grows, and it can never be repaid. And so we're at the stage globally where that debt mountain is so big that it will cannibalize. That's why I use cancer as my metaphor. It will eat the host alive. Sustainability cannot be achieved unless you address how the money system works and how money is created. As long as money is created as a debt, it will continue to destroy the very life capital of the planet and ourselves. And we are responsible for it because we've created it. And we can repatriate the power of money creation back to the people, as Jefferson, you know, and Benjamin Franklin foresaw, you know, at the revolution in the United States. This is a profound, these are profound things that most people aren't even paying attention to. So the collapse in the United States is a perfect window for courage by Congress, by the President, to repatriate the power of money creation, as Abraham Lincoln himself forewarned against, and which happened with the Federal Reserve establishment in 1913. Same thing in Canada, Britain, France, everywhere on the planet. These are huge macroeconomic changes that have to be put into place now. We need to be aware, people need to be aware of how these things work. Progress to me is defined in terms of happiness. Happiness in Greek means well-being of the spirit. In the indigenous cultures that I studied, progress is in the form of a medicine wheel. We are four aspects, emotional, physical, mental, and spiritual. What the First Nations have taught me is progress is driven by what? Volition, free will. In the center of that wheel where the crosshairs, where those four attributes meet, that is progress. Each one of us can look in the mirror and say, is our medicine wheel balanced? And we can look, scale it up to societal. So to me, progress is about whether society and community is flourishing. That's different than sustainability. Flourishing means it's kind of like a standing wave of joy. Are you achieving your life purpose? Why are you here? Why are we collectively here? What are we working for? It is the question of progress. And I think that has to do with ultimately happiness, which in Greek means well-being of the spirit. Well, I take the Mother Teresa approach. You know, the change starts when you wake up in the morning. The choice of what shampoo you use, what coffee you bought, where you bought your vegetables, do you walk your kids to school or do you drive them to school? All these little choices add up to well-being. They're about setting priorities. They're about aligning your choices with your values. They're about being conscious of every dollar you spend, you vote, you express a value. Are your expression of expenditures, are they congruent with your values? Then at the individual level, that happens at the kitchen table with your family. You have conversations around the dinner table about how your day was. Was it congruent with your life purpose? Did you feel joy from your day? Did your work bring you meaning? Did your kids learn something meaningful at school, or they just learn something that will apply to the grand meritocracy of our industrial complex? So individually, I see it happening every day in my community in Edmonton, and I see it happening around the world. So it gives me great hope that at the individual level, we are not paralyzed. We are very powerful. And when we mobilize and when we become conscious and act with virtue, then the world will change.